There's a big misunderstanding where many people think that work is a curse. In fact, if you ask anybody, they will say clearly, oh, don't you know we were cursed? And they will normally quote Genesis chapter 3. So that basically we feel like when we are working, we are just in line with the curse. And even after getting saved, you still work. So it sounds like the curse continues. And I want to say that if that is your view, I want us to check from the scriptures and you'll be able to see that it's not scriptural. That view may be taught by your pastor, but it's not scriptural. We don't work as a curse. God created us to work. So when you don't work, it's when you're being an unchristian. Christians must work. And it's not a curse. It is a blessing. If you are going to be good at work, you must work within your mission. Your vision and mission. So you need, before you can start saying, I want to go to bid work. No, for now you must go in the afternoon to bid work. I'm talking about making bid work your profession. You must answer the question, what has God called you to be? Because if you do beadwork and God has not called you in that area, at the end of the journey you'll be asked, have you done what I created you for? And then you'll produce beadwork. Say, that was somebody else's work. What have you done? Picture being left by your mother, you're not too old by the time you're in university. Your father and mother are going away, they leave you, four of you, and you have to agree, your work will be washing plates, yours will be making ugali, mine will be washing the toilet. I mean, we divide up work. Then, you like my work of washing toilets. So you decide to wash toilets. When your parents come, they discover that there has not been food in the house for the 3 days they have been away. Then they say, what happened? No. I was washing toilets. What in the process happened? You helped the other person and forgot to do your own work. Are you going to get commendation?
No.
Yet the truth is, you worked. So I want to emphasize to you, as a Christian, you dare not do a job because your uncle does it, or your mother did it, or it gives you a lot of money. You must answer the question, is that God's calling on your life? I know this message is really contra the general view. There are many people seated here who are taking courses that has nothing to do with their calling. Am I right?
Yes.
Why? Because you got an A and all your uncles gathered. You wanted to do history. You are interested in a history, archaeology, that kind of area. They said you can't waste an A on such things. So they gathered in a conference to mention to their niece or nephew, please wake up. God has given you an A. Don't waste it. I speak in medical school the first time I was in medical school was 1975 or 76, but I've kept going. And I always see them and say, you have my sympathies. Because many people who do medicine are not interested in blood. Either pouring it or preventing it. No. They simply are not interested. But if you get an A, you know, once you have an A, it means you are good in both science and art. Am I right? So, nobody, he says, this family has never had a doctor. All your cousins gather together. We must have a doctor in our family. So you are forced to do medicine. And I know a number of people whom I have known after that, who finally finished medicine and left it. Because they can't cope. Unless they want to die early. Living with the blood, it's just draining them. And it's something we need to talk about. Okay, I should be talking to your parents. But since you you'll be parents soon, not so soon, I hope. Now, since you'll be parents, I think it's important to understand what I'm talking about. That God creates every human being for a particular purpose. And your purpose is not my purpose. So before you start thinking about the work you'll do, please, please, find out what has God called you to do. I've written a book called The Christian Professional, and I have a chapter there on how to discover your life's purpose. Because I think it's one of the most important things for young people. But it's not my topic today. But let me mention it right at the beginning. It is important that you discover your purpose. Do not take a job because it's famous. If it be famous, your cousin will be happy, but you'll be dying. And you must remember, you're not living your cousin's life. You are living your own life. At the end of the journey, God cannot say, well done, because you are doing somebody else's work. So it's important to identify not what your mother did, not what your father did, not what your uncle did, or what, especially in Kenya, it's always, if you do that, where will you get money? We don't work to get money. We work to serve the Lord. Amen. Last time I was here, I emphasized the fact that serving the Lord does not mean working for TF or for Focus or for the church. Some of you are there, am I right? Yes. And we said serving the Lord is doing what he has created you to do. Some of you, God has created you to create roads, civil engineers. And if you don't exist, we'll continue to suffer. So for the only way God will say well done is how many roads have you constructed? Have you designed? If you preach just preaching, you are doing somebody else's job. It's important to understand, if you are a pastor, when God has called you to be a civil engineer, at the end of the journey, you will not be told well done. So it's important to understand that, like we said that time, that whichever work you do, it must be work which you can say, I am serving God. Whether it's engineering or it's law, whichever. So that's one of the things I wanted to mention. You must, what is vision? Vision is a description of your achievement at the end of your life. When you talk about vision, it's a noun. It's what you have achieved by the end of your life. And you need to pray that God gives you a vision of the impact you will make at the end of your life. Like I said, or like I also say in my book, the best exercise I know of is the one my wife told me about, that she gives to her students. Write your eulogy now. You know what is eulogy? That is, in other words, the people that will bury your body, they will not bury you. You know, you are unbearable. Christians do not believe a human being can be buried. Because by the time they are burying your body, you are already with the Lord, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So even if they try to bury you, are you bearable? No, you are not bearable. So it's important to understand, they can never bury you. And when you keep saying, we are burying Nganga, you are contradicting the scriptures. You can never bury Nganga. You can only bury the body of? By that time, Nganga has? That's why whether you put me in a mahogany coffin or in a gunia, it will not affect me at all. In fact, if you refuse to bury me, it still doesn't affect me. I'll smell on you. We do not, you know, they say we are giving the last respect. You are not giving me any respect at all. In a burial, you don't give the respect to the dead. You give the respect to the living. Burial is about the living. The parents or the children, they are now devastated because they have lost a loved one. The whole burial process is to be able to comfort them. Are we together? Mm-hmm. The Bible says, mourn with those who mourn, rejoice with those who rejoice. So you need to understand that. So back to the point. So writing a eulogy is not a big thing. Because writing a eulogy is after the guy has gone, is describing the impact the guy made when he was alive. So pray and God will give you a vision of the kind of impact you will make on your wife, whom you don't have yet. But it's important now, before you marry, you write a eulogy that your wife will read. Are we together? Because by that theology, it will determine the type of girl you can marry. Because you see, if she is going to read that, oh, like you hear, you are writing theology and you say, you hear your wife saying, the guy that has gone is my lovely husband. And he has taught me to walk with the Lord. So if she is not a Christian, can she say that? No. So it means that you cannot marry an un-Christian. Are we together? So you say the person I have the person that has gone. Now I'm talking about a girl. Is my husband of many years, and you can say clearly he actually has looked after me to be who I am today. Now, so if it is somebody, a man who doesn't care about you, cares more about himself, he can't be happy about that, is he? So you need to write a eulogy. And when you have written all the eulogies of all the people you intend to impact, that summary will now draw a conclusion. That conclusion is the vision of your life. Vision is a noun. The impact you have made. Once you have the vision, now you come to your mission. What is mission? Mission is about what you do in order to achieve the
vision.
That is what mission. Mission is about. You can never, when you write a mission statement, you must talk about what you or what the organization will do in order to achieve the vision. But sometimes people mix mission and a vision. Mission is simply something you will do. So once you have seen the vision, it will help you to see what is it God intends to do with your life so that you can achieve that which will honor him. So there's the people who are reading the various eulogies. Your son, your daughter, your church minister, your professional colleague. And they are reading the eulogy. They will be referring to the impact God used you to make in their lives. Now work is going to be part of that. So you will do the job that can help you to achieve the vision. Are we together? And that's why it is important that whatever you do, if you are going to do something that is going to really that's going to be useful, it will have to be something within your life. What's your life mission? Number two, where you work will also be determined by your mission. Because if the mission of the organization is different from your mission, you will be there to make money, but at the end you will not be told, well done. Are we together? So you cannot go getting a job in a place that does not meet your mission. For example, your neighbor here is breweries. So if you join the breweries, you must be aware about their mission, isn't it? So if your mission and theirs don't agree, however much they pay you, you'll be in the wrong place. Because their mission is to help people to forget their problems through drinking. Your mission is to help people to find their solution in God. Are you going the same direction?
No.
No. So it's important to understand even where you work will be determined by their mission versus. Can you see so far we are not talking about the salary, are we? No. Talking about, so you need to find out who this person is. And finally, even in your department where you work, you'll be asking, how does it fit? Now, if you are going to perform well, therefore, my first point is, you must perform within your mission. Next, you need an internal motivation rather than an external motivation. If you are having external motivation, chances are it will run out. Those external resources have a way of running out. Motivation runs out if it's external. What is external motivation? I'm working very hard for money. That's outside, isn't it? So if the guy doesn't pay you, will you still work? No. Or if you work, it will not be a good job. You must avoid external motivation. Three things. Number one, the outsider to continue encouraging you means he must be happy with you. As soon as he thinks he does not like what you are doing, he's unlikely to continue encouraging you. So, if you rely on outside motivation, be ready to soon lose it or be on a roller coaster. Up down. And many of you, even in class, that's where you work. When the teacher sounds happy with you, you do well. If he sounds unhappy, you do badly. Because you are depending on external motivation. You need to have, that's why I emphasize in the introduction, the importance of having an agreement with God about who you are. So you'll be working in order to meet your mission. Are we together? What the outsider does is irrelevant. The lecturer may like you, not like you. The boss may like you, not like you. It doesn't affect you. If you rely on external motivation, then you have put yourself into somebody's control. He can do whatever. And that is even if the person is your boyfriend. It's still dangerous. Do not go to your boyfriend for motivation. Go to your boyfriend to enjoy the results of your work. Are we together?
Yes.
Share with him the things that you are doing, the things the Lord is doing. But don't start thinking that the boyfriend, because why? Number one, I'm saying number one, is that people are not always happy with you. And even your boyfriend is not always happy with you. Okay, when you marry your husband, not always happy with you. I've been married after 6 years, and I know there are things I have done my wife that simply does not like. So if I was to depend on her during the time she's annoyed with me, I'll be in trouble, isn't it? Only God is a constant factor. Am I right? So it's important to understand that if you rely on somebody else, your work performance is certainly going to be affected. You need to see, why do I do what I do? Is it because my mother said? That's not a good reason to do it. Your mother may say it, and then it's a way of God confirming what he has told you. So the reason you are working is not because your mother said, but because God talked to you, and God confirmed using your mother. So even if your mother changes, you still continue, isn't it? Because then you have a witness in your spirit that what you are doing is what God has asked you to do. You need that witness. Because even your mother can change. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah. All she needs, sometimes it's very interesting. All you need, like you go to university, and then your father is so impressed that he's always talking about you. Within no time, your mother starts getting jealous. Very unfortunate, isn't it? Yeah, why are you always talking about her? And she now starts competing as if you are her age mate. Whenever your mother says, I'm going to Kenyatta to visit my daughter, say, but are you forgetting that my grandmother needs to be visited? Now, it's a competition. You need to understand that is true of anybody. And the point, your boyfriend is also the same. If what you are doing is doing well, he starts feeling threatened. Can I marry such a performer? God, are you not talking? Okay, feeling threatened. So you end up changing your direction because of this other person. So what I'm trying to get to see, remember our topic is work. And I'm saying you're not a good performer at all if you do not have an internal. And why? I am saying because people keep changing. Second thing that makes external motivation a problem is the fact that man is a foreign creature and nobody wants to be outdone. I've already talked about that. So the first one is that people keep changing up, down. Second one is jealousy. And it is hidden in every man and every woman. That somehow, and you know, I was, the reason why I prefer to parents is because I was speaking in a conference in Mombasa, maybe 10, 15 years ago. And I kept saying that your mother, don't just rely on people talking to you. Your mother loves you. She's the one who wants the very best for you. So it's important to always check with your mother. Now, when you went out for tea, as a Zimbabwean girl who was attending the conference said, Mr. Nau, could I talk to you? Yes. So we went to a corner and she said, I know what you are saying may be based on your facts, but it's not true in my case. So what do you mean? Say she was now somebody in her 30s. She said, my mother is a teacher, my father is a teacher. When I became somebody in my 20s, my first boyfriend was a doctor, qualified doctor. And whenever he came home, I came and introduced him at home. My mother took the trouble, after the boy went, to tell me, I am wrong. Not because God has said, but because, can't you see our class? We are not the type to be married by doctors. We are teacher level. You know, are you getting the point? In the mother's idea, is the girl is aiming too high. Because she's a daughter of a teacher. But you know, they are in love. But I want to tell you, the mother, according to the story I was given, the mother worked on that boy until the relationship broke. Every time the boy came, I thought, are you must be misled. My daughter cannot cope. My daughter this, my daughter the other, my daughter the other, until the boy finally, and he says, we never ended up marrying, and my mother was a cause. And when I started the thing, I knew it was simply jealousy. That she did not want her daughter to marry above her. You know, it sounds strange, isn't it? But now I learned that jealousy hides in every man and every woman. You can manage it, you can see God's help, but it's always there tempting you. So this second thing is a very important thing to understand, that if you are relying on someone, you'll be surprised. You know, sometimes it's very difficult to even know who, like when you're having a personal problem at work, it's very difficult to know who to share with. Because if you share with your boss that, you know, I just messed up, we are losing a customer, what do you think the boss is likely to do? Fire you. I mean, because you see, your loss is his loss, isn't it? He doesn't want somebody who is going to make him fired. So before he can be fired, you know, fire you. So you are unable to share with him. If you decide to share with your subordinate, that's worse. Your subordinate has been eyeing your job. Your subordinate believes that your job, you are not as good as him. Then you tell him how you feel. Within no time, he'll be talking to your boss. Telling, I know I'm not qualified to be the manager, but I also know that you have not speaking correctly. You know, our boss, like he did this and this and this, surely, is that the person who should be leading us? So, you are subordinate, what do you? Now, try your colleague, that's worse. Because somebody in another department, the same level, once he hears your story, and remember, you're all competing for the same job, isn't it? Because your boss is one. There are several of you competing for one job, isn't it? You'll tell him as quickly as possible. I am not suggesting that when you go, you give me your work. I don't know who you will give it, but I know who you should not give it. So you need to understand external motivation. There'll be trouble. Are we together? Yeah. That's why I'm encouraging you to know what has God called you to do, then work to please God. Are we together? Very, very important. Thirdly, the external motivation comes from mortal man. In other words, it's not that he's being jealous, he's simply mortal. Your uncle may be the one who has given you motivation this far. The next time he is knocked by a car on the road, he's no longer available. What happens to your motivation? Is that true? Yeah. There's, and it doesn't matter how old or young your uncle is. He has a sell-by date, isn't it? Yeah. And unfortunately, it's not written on him. It's with the Lord. Now, so when his sell-by date comes, is he around? No. And anyway, let's understand that most people older than you, not all, are going to die earlier than. So how will it motivate you after that? So can you see the danger of external motivation? You need to find out what your motivation is. And I'm not suggesting you don't talk to people, but you talk to them to confirm what God has already said. And if they talk to you first, go and check from the Lord. So that in the end, you are not doing it because they said, you are doing it because you now know it is God who used them to tell you. Are we together?
Yes.
You know, when we talk about work, there are many, many different understandings of work. You ask people, and a research was done, why do you work? One person said, so that I can earn a living. That's not going to motivate you very much. Because if you are to earn a living, some people strike it rich. By the age of 40, They have so much money, even if they did nothing, they have enough money to lift them until they are 80. Are you getting the point? Bill Gates now no longer works. He, in his area of interest, he is now a social worker. A friend of mine told me they met in Tanzania with him. In the farms. He's a social worker. And another time he was photographed in our Kenyan papers, just wearing a shirt in the streets of Eldoret. He's a social worker. Now, the only thing is that he's a social worker with a difference. Normally social workers are paid. Now he's the one who pays the people. Are you getting the difference? Bill Gates Foundation with his money, and is the one paying for his trips. But the point is, you need to understand, if you are going to work to earn a living, you will not live very long. Because you can get that money before you are 40. Have you read the book called Rich Dad, Poor Dad? Yes. Totally a Christian book. It tells you to work hard so that you stop working at the age of 40. Have you read it? Those who have read it, am I right?
Yes.
Now, which scripture would take that? Which scripture would you use? You know, I worked for Shell for about 30 years. And finally they said I was old. Although I'm not old, I'm only in my early 60s. Now, but the point is, from the time I retired, God has opened so many doors that have been busier than I was when I was in employment. Why? It's only Cheryl said they don't want to work with me because of my years. But the Lord had not decided. In fact, the term retirement is unscriptural. In the scripture, check anywhere. David, Joseph, whoever, nobody ever
retired.
It's not a Christian concept. We work until the Lord calls us
home.
So I'm grateful to the Lord that now I can talk from testimony the last number of years that I have after Shell, which clearly helped me. Just the last 2 months, in July I was in Kigali. Then again somebody called me in August, I've been in Kigali. Somehow. And in September, I'm in Zambia. These are things that never happened when I was in Shell. But God opens doors that I never knew about. You need to understand we don't work to earn a living. We work to fulfill our mission. You see the difference? And because as you fulfill your mission, you are benefiting people, they pay you to do what you should be doing anyway. Okay, to the point. So you'll not stop doing it after you are called retiree. You'll continue doing it even if they pay you no money. You know, the difference is I used to travel out for Shell, but I was paid per diem. Now I go to Kigali, speak in the conference, and I can't earn nothing. But the work is still going on. Am I right?
Yes.
So you need to start understanding, we don't work to earn a living. We work to fulfill the mission, but in the process we earn a living. Are you getting the difference? Very, 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 very important. So it is not right. That idea is not a good idea. Another one says, so that I can take care of my family. Now, if you are working in order to take care of your family, then you might not even get to the age of 45. Because if you marry at the age of, you leave university what time? What age? 22. Now, if you leave university at 22, please work for 2 years. Now, if you marry at 24, your child will be 24 when? When you're how many?
48.
And they leave. After that, they work for themselves. Am I right? So who do you work for? And you're just a young boy of 48. If I'm in my 60s, if you're 48, are you not a child? Are you getting my point?
Yes.
You don't work in order to assist your family. You work to fulfill God's calling, and in the process, you are paid money that meets your family's
needs.
So even at your children adults, and these days, like now, I've just left the house, just Rebecca and me. Rebecca is my girlfriend of the last 40 years or so. Now, it's important to understand, we're just the two of us. We started the two of us, then he got children, then she stopped sending me because she had that to say, now I'm back to them. Bring that. I'm done one second. Now, you need to understand things change, isn't it? Now, I do not work to help my children because they are all adults. The last one has also gotten married. My last one finished university 07. The last one finished university 07. So you need to understand clearly, I'll not be as busy as I am. After here, I'm going somewhere else. And those are people paying me. I'll be with a group of people from petroleum industry. Now, it's important to understand, I don't do what I do to support my family. By the grace of God, my family supports itself. My wife is a lecturer in Desta, so at least she's earning. So I'm retired, but I'm still busy. But not because they need my money. It's because I'm fulfilling God's calling on my life. Are you getting the point?
Yes.
So you, and I'm not suggesting you don't support your family. But if that's the reason, then you die early. Feeling idle and without any hope, without any direction. You know, Dr. Katera said that most people who are retiring, in those days, people are retiring at the age of 55. And he says most of them die within 3 years. You retire, you have been a manager, very busy. Then you retire at 55, and you don't know what to do. Your children by that time have finished school. You have no motivation to work. You will go home. Within no time, you are a drunkard. For 3 reasons. Number one, you have the time, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Not like your place of work. Number two, you realize nobody cares about you. You arrive at your shopping center, and you even say one for everyone. You know, one beer for everyone. You expect them to be impressed. They just continue talking like you are not there. So you tell them, I'm the former managing director of Kokoko Limited. Oh, they have never heard of Kokoko. So they continue talking. They ignore you 2-3 days, and after some time, you feel totally useless. Then one day, the agriculture officer comes visiting your farm, and your wife who had gone earlier is the one known. So you hear from the gate, is the owner of the home in? Now, he said, yes. I said, no, not you, the owner. You realize, as far as people are concerned, who is the owner?
Your wife.
You can quarrel her, but she's not the one who did it. Are you starting to see the problem of all this? Because you have no reason. So the second reason is feeling like you have no consequence, and you are used to power. You have no power. The third reason is once you have the first two have happened, you feel purposeless. And the easiest killer is lack of purpose. So within 3 years, you are gone. So you need to understand that if you don't want to die before your time, it is important you have a purpose that goes beyond your children's education. Are we together? So we work. Not in order to be that, some people say, so that I can make some money. In other words, you own a heap of money. You know, you realize all you are saving is only 20 shillings. Now, but you look forward to when the 20 shillings can become 20 million. So you work very hard to get the money. But you know, I've just been reading a book. I'm reading a book called The Road Most Traveled. There's a more popular one called The Road Less Traveled. But this one says The Road Most Traveled. And he is saying, clearly, you need to, and he is giving his own father's example. And he is saying the father was a saver, really saved. Then he just one day was asked to die, I don't know, pancreatic cancer. And he was given 3 months, although he actually lived 4 months. And he says he's the firstborn, the writer is the firstborn. They were talking, and the father said, you know, this is very interesting. I've worked so hard to save. Now I'm giving the money to somebody else. Of course, I'm an embarrassing statement. But you realize clearly if you are working to make money, you will make money. By the time you are dying, it will kill you faster. Because how can all this money go to my children who are so hopeless, not hardworking, whatever you feel like, no, they cannot get. Some people even give their money to a cat. Have you heard of it? But if somebody is giving his wealth to a cat, it tells you he already has trouble, isn't it? He doesn't even know where he is going. Are you getting the point?
Yeah.
So you need to understand that making money, just to see money, is the easiest way to end up in frustration. You know, you make 20 billion. Just to discover the other one hasn't made 20 million. He has made 20 billion. And you feel, higher. You mean I'm so poor? Now, although 20 billion is a lot of money, but once you discover, and you know, there's another thing he has given the American income levels. And he says in the book, in fact, he asks you in the book, when you look at the table, what did you compare first? And then he answers his little question, says, most likely, you look at what percentage of people earn more than you. That is the danger of money. Because you never compare with one who has less. You always compare with the one who has more. Why are you working? So that I can have a car. Now, the day you get a car, so you're no longer in number 11. Now, you need to understand that as soon as that happens, you feel so great. Until you are driving to go into a supermarket, then your former classmate drives a Mercedes. What? Who is he saying? You feel like you have no car. So if you work to make money, please accept my sympathy in advance. You will never have joy. Are we together?
Yeah.
Of course, if you work, money will come. Not even 20 million. 20 billion might come. But your mind is not on the 20 billion. Your mind is fulfilling your mission. Are we together? So that is the, if you really want to enjoy your life, it will be important that you are clear about that mission. Emphasis is usually on time spent in exchange of monetary reward, not on mission. And that's what is the problem. You know, some people say work is evil, but it's a necessary evil. In other words, they don't want to work. But what else can they do? So for them, they have no reason to work. It's only that they will die if they don't work. Some people say it's a way of occupying your time until retirement. Others say something may even appear meaningless and laborious, and we yearn for retirement when we shall pass time in leisure pursuits. You feel like, I hope I retire. Then I do nothing. Just do nothing long enough, and you'll also become nothing. Are you getting the point? Common work experience. If you talk to many people, they'll tell you work is stressful. And you know, if you are a boss, you are stressed by your subordinates. If you are a subordinate, you are stressed by your ensures everybody is
stressed.
By the time you leave at 6 or 5 or whatever time, all of you are going
stressed.
It really doesn't matter, because when I was very junior in the 1970s, I used to hope if I became manager, then I wanted to become manager, and I really wished for the days I was not supervising anybody. Because if you are supervising yourself, you have a job, but nobody is under you. Unaitwanga until you get results. The day I was made a supervisor, I discovered how difficult. Because my boss assumes all people under me are me. If one of them fails, who has failed?
You.
And I feel it's very unfair. It's not me. I gave this guy what? He didn't do it. He says, I don't want to know that. We told you to achieve. How come you never? And I discovered it's far much better to be given a task to do than to be asked to supervise people doing it. So the frustration begins the day you are made a supervisor. Because among your 10 staff, there will always be one who is anointed to frustrate you. Causes you a lot of stress. So if you don't have a good reason, people resign. Have you had people resign to do nothing? Yeah, especially your age mate. You just say, what happened? I couldn't work there. So what are you going to eat? Now you need to understand clearly that if you don't have an internal reason to work, work environment can be very frustrating. But you know something? When you are doing your mission, frustrations of work cannot reach you. Are you together? The other day I was speaking in one of the churches. When I came out, a lady stopped me and told me, I just wanted you to know that my husband works in Afghanistan and he really benefits you from your cassette. Says, where do you get them? Says, wherever we know you have spoken, we go and buy cassettes. Said, I asked, what did you say? Your husband is where? Afghanistan. How did he go there? Because those are now several years ago when there was a problem in Afghanistan every other week. So I wondered, how can somebody volunteer to go to such a place? No. He said, no. He is happy. The Lord has taken him there. He is enjoying it. I've never forgotten that story. That you can take yourself to Vietnam, to Afghanistan, and be happy to be there, where bullets are flying and missing on a continuous basis. But he feels he has a mission to help them who are in security issues. Because if everybody runs away, like we have done from Garissa, there'll be no hope, isn't it? So he goes there. Now, that story was so impressive. The next time I was in a different church in Karen, and I repeated the story because it impressed me. When I was out, people coming to greet, he came with her husband and said, this is the man you're talking about. I was very embarrassed. If I knew he was in, I wasn't going to repeat the story. But he told me, what you said is okay. Is that what you said? It is true. I am happy to be working in Afghanistan. I'm saying all that to tell you, you cannot be stressed by the stressors of work. Whereas what you are doing is anointed from heaven. You know the frustrated guy will still be there. But every time you are tempted to be frustrated, you remember God has still placed you there to achieve a mission. Okay, isn't that point? It will make a lot of difference. Sometimes one of the things that causes you trouble in the place is too much politics in the workplace. I tell you, company politics is frustrating. People are always talking about each other and trying to outdo each other. Some of it is called backstabbing. Ever heard of backstabbing?
Yes.
Somebody will be smiling. Then you think he's your greatest friend. Then you even share your weakness. The next time you hear them from the boss, I hear you have a weakness for girls. How can you say such a thing? I just want to be very fast. So I should not be allocating you duties of girls. Now, you wonder who could have said, but it's not personal. That is called back? Yeah, because you wouldn't face me. You wait until I turn my back then, and I'll die properly. Now you need to understand it clearly. It is as being at work that's quite often. That the people you trust are the ones. Sorry. The only solution to backstabbers is to have the Lord at your back. Every time they want to stab, you hold your hand. Because that's what he did. That's what he did when Abraham wanted to cut his son's head. Just when the panther was up, you go, and God can do that for you and me. Can he?
Yes.
So, but if you stay there thinking, you now stop me. No. Wait a minute. You'll be in trouble. You'll be frustrated. You learn the company politics and backstabbing is not something that disturbs you. The other one is called bootlicking. What is bootlicking? Bootlicking is you see the boss coming, you run for his back. You even tell him, you even quickly rub him, or you know, try to clean up his shirt, although it was killed by a messenger. You are trying to be so helpful to the boss, so that during promotion he remembers you. Now, that's a dangerous thing, because you might lick the boots of the boss to be clean enough to kick you out. Because he knows clearly, for you to be boot licking, you're not a performer. So you'll be looking for a way. What is it that this guy is expecting? Say, no, this guy is not good in my team. So after you have licked the boots and they are clean, and the frustration level will be very high. Because you are sure you're protected because of your friendship with the boot. Then he's going to get you out. So boot licking is not something that you'll be tempted to do. Because you have protection from heaven. Then there's something called blame games. Your subordinates never accept they did something wrong. They always say, it is you who never give us good instructions. I don't know what, but you know, the way you write your English, how could we understand? Even when you are clear, they understood. They never accept. And it can be very frustrating if that's what you are going through. It can be very frustrating if that's what you are going through. Are you getting about work? Mm-hmm. My job was to prepare you for workplace. Are you getting to understand how it works? Mm-hmm. The solution to it, because I survived it, is to have God on your side and to do that which God has called you to do. Then you are assured of his protection. The other thing that is terrible in the place of work is competition. There is something called cutthroat competition. It's called cutthroat because people are trying to cut you. Cut your throat. And it doesn't matter whether you work for a Christian organization or work wherever you work. Everybody feels it's called the scarcity mentality. What's scarcity mentality? Scarcity mentality is believing the only way I can go up is by somebody else going
down.
I grew up during the Mau Mau era. I was a small boy. I was born 1952. So those years of Mau Mau, I was born just before Mau Mau, the emergency was declared. So I grew up with that. And there wasn't enough food because we were all put into villages. But it's only that time we did not know the term IDP. We were, now I know we should have been called. We were internally displaced. But it meant that you only work since you could, you know, the village was surrounded by a trench, around us, with the spears everywhere. So if you try to jump over, you'll be speared. There was only one gate, and you couldn't go outside the hours. The journeys, the British soldiers were called journeys, while the journeys could allow you. Now, that meant we had poverty, isn't it? So, if ugali is put and it's not enough ugali, and you are 6 children, you say, in the name of the Lord, amen. You attack. Because how much got your stomach depends on the speed of your hands. Unfortunately, some people, even as ugali became much, they still rush for it. Because they entered in their mind the scarcity mentality. They believe that I can only do well if somebody else does badly. Which is not true. Because it's possible that as you work hard, all of you, the company will expand, and you're not just one person will be promoted. The departments are being opened, new branches are being opened. All of you will become managers at the same time. So you need to ask yourself, do you have scarcity mentality? Why do you think everybody can't get an A? So that you keep hiding the books. You take a book out of the library so that you are the only one with it the whole time. You return it, you borrow it. You return it, you borrow it. That is scarcity. So competition is a sign of scarcity mentality. It can be cutthroat. So the workplace, you know, the difference with, that's why I gave you the joining review. If you are doing something God has called you to do, you know you are not doing it to be better than somebody else. You are doing it to praise the Lord. And in God's way of measuring, he does not compare you with somebody else. He compares you with yourself. He understands your capacity. He knows whether you are lazy. You know, in our days, there were schools that were called Harambee schools. Harambee schools were community schools. They could not get government teachers. Now, if you became number one in Harambee school, and the best person had that division, number one is in that division, isn't it? But if you went to Alliance, and you are number 80, you will still be in first division. So, doing better than somebody else doesn't help. The solution for you in Harambee school is not to compete against your classmates. Competing against yourself. What will happen? You'll get an A, and the next person has that division. That's a sign you are not competing with them. Because if you are competing with them, and all of you are mediocre, the best mediocre becomes number one. But all of you are still mediocre. Am I communicating? Yeah. So in your place of work, you must cease from competing with others. Compete with yourself. Am I doing better this time than I was doing the previous time? Could I have done this exercise better than I did it? So although your boss is so happy about your results, deep down you know, next time I have exercise, I'll do it in a different way. But if you rely on the competition and your boss keeps saying you are the best person, because of course you are the best mediocre, then obviously you remain mediocre. Are you getting the point? And that's a danger with the place of work, competition. Then there's someone pressure to deliver and to succeed. That pressure is the kind of pressure that makes you live an unbalanced life. You work so hard, and because of the pressure, you forget to live a balanced life. Like, and that happens even to students. During exams, they have no quiet time. They have accepted noisy time the whole time. And because they only had noisy time with no quiet time, now they fail. Am I right? You need to understand quiet time is not for when you have no exams. Quiet time, you need it even more when you have
exams.
So you need to understand that same problem is at work. As you get pressure to finish assignments, your spiritual life goes down. But if you remember you are not working to just please your boss, you are working to please God, will you be tempted to stop your spiritual growth?
No.
The other thing you understand is, because God has called you, in my book, The Christian Leader, Source of Influence, is a book that was written out of a conference organized by Trinity Fellowship called IPA Conference. Was it 03 or 00? Who was that?
03.
03?
Yes.
Yeah, and I was the main speaker for the conference. Out of the conference, people, they were taping. So since I saw a lot of people after the tapes, I decided to make it a book. And in the book, I'm saying that you need to understand, for you to do what you are doing well, in order to do well, you need to divide your life into seven areas. Three areas when broken further becomes so. That is your private life, your personal life, and your public life. And that balance must be maintained. Private is called private because nobody else can enter there. For example, your prayer life with God is private. Even your wife cannot know that you pray. The only time she knows you pray is when you're having family prayers. And family prayers do not replace personal
prayers.
A lot of people, once they marry, they no longer pray. After all, the wife is such a prayer. Is that English? No. You must have personal time. It's a private thing between you, God, and you. Number two is ability to develop intellectually. Nobody else can develop it for you. Your wife can't. You have to make a commitment. God has given him praise for his use. It is you that will determine how to develop yourself intellectually, even like me in my 60s. Did I tell you I'm reading a book? I made a commitment in 1969 that I'll always be reading a book, not to pass exams, but for my personal growth. And from 1969 until now, by the grace of God, I'm always reading. The only thing is, don't ask me how fast. When my children were in high school, they would leave me reading a book, they go away. When they come over midterm and I'm still reading the same thing, Papa, how can you be reading the same book? I committed myself to be reading, I didn't say how fast. But I'm always reading. Because I know it is reading that will develop my mind. And that is personal. Nobody else is forcing me. It's a personal decision. Are we together? And you have to make up your mind that God gave you a brain for a purpose. And then, anyway, but if you do that, you better read the book yourself. But all I'm trying to say is, there is private life, then personal life. Personal life is where you relate with your wife, your children, and your close friends. And for most of us, we don't require more than our fingers to count those people in the personal area. You don't require your toes. You have many acquaintances, but very few friends. I've written a book on friendship, and I have a checklist. I put in the book a checklist of who a friend is. So that you stop calling acquaintances
friends.
Even people in your fellowship are not necessarily your friends. They are just your fellowshippers. Fellows in the same ship. Now, fellowship. But it's important you understand, you need, for you to really be what God wants you to do, you must develop into a personal area. So that the thing God is showing you in your private area, you can pilot them in your personal area before you take it in the public
area.
Unless you might discover something. And you say, hallelujah, new revelation. Please share it with your personal area. So they'll tell you, wait a minute, this is the devil. This verse. Don't just stand up in a PM conference. Hallelujah, I was in the mountaintop. First of all, go to your personal area. Am I communicating?
Yes.
It's important that every one of us has a friend whom they can share with. And a friend who is not threatened. You know, like if you share with your girlfriend, she might fear if she says something, you will drop her like a hot potato. So she will not. So that one does not qualify. You need a friend who is not threatened. He or she is ready to lose you, but can be honest with you. Those are very few people, isn't it? Most friends really don't want to lose you. So they would rather you go to hell, but not lose you. Now you need somebody in that personal area who can help you. Are we together?
Yes.
Then now, that will prepare you to go to the public. And your performance in public will be far much better. When you have. So this idea, pressure to deliver, that makes you forget your personal area. And the pressure to deliver is in the public area. You must know, for you to do well in the public area, you must do well in your private area and in your. And you must never sacrifice your private area for your public area. Are we together? You cannot, you know. You need to understand that in life, all issues are graded on the following criteria. Number one, does it please the Lord? Number two, does it please my wife? Number three, others are there. Does it please me and others? Now, the important thing is, you need to understand clearly. If you get a new job, number one, does it please God? Number two, does it please my wife? If it doesn't please your wife, you need to be careful. Are we together? So it's important to, but the critical thing is, your wife must backslide. So before you say, does it please my wife? Ask, does it please?
God.
Are we together? So all I'm saying here is, the workplace should not pressurize you to give up on your private day. Am I clear? Because you're talking about work and the various challenges of work. Even competition for top place in the pyramid and can be all-consuming and at times even unhealthy. Let me now go through a number of... I want to allow time for... We have to go until 1:15, am I right? 1:15, isn't it? So just a few quotations and then I'll finish. Charles Hardy, in an essay entitled Organization for Masochists in Waiting for the Mountain to Move, says, thinking about it the other day, I realized some of my unhappiest moments have been in organizations. In my worst moments, I have thought that the organization were places designed to be run by sadists and starved by masochists. Why does it sometimes have to be so awful? In other words, you need to be aware. Most organizations, it seems like people enjoy to see you suffer. Please note the word masochist is gratification gained from pain, deprivation, and deprivation. Can you imagine? See, the boss seems happier when you suffer. That's why, for example, if he knows you are from Kisumu, he will send you to Mandera. If he asks you are from Mandera, he will quickly book you to Mombasa. It's like he is unhappy if you are happy. And that can create quite a problem. Let's now finish with looking at the beginning of work. Is work a curse? Look at Genesis 3:17. To Adam he said, because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground. Since from it you are taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return. That's the curse. So, you ask yourself, does it then mean work is a curse? Just look at Genesis 2:15. Which comes earlier? Genesis 2 or Genesis 3? Now, so before Adam did any evil, what was he doing? Just look at Genesis 2:15. And the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to rest. Is that what your Bible says? And the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to retire. Is that what your Bible says? What does it say? And the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to do work in it and take care of it. Hear me clearly. People look forward to going to heaven to do nothing. That's not possible. When we are in heaven, we shall be very busy, but we enjoy. So the difference between work before the curse and work after the curse is the drudgery and frustration of work. But work was there even before the curse. Are we together? So it's important to understand even in heaven. You know. Now, and I'm finishing with this. I want to tell you the way we are created, if you don't work, my friend, you cannot enjoy life. Let's assume that you are going to earn, on average, after you're employed, you give the low one, end up with the higher one, but on average, you earn 100,000 Kenya shillings, just a guess. Is that a bad salary?
No.
100,000, is that a bad salary?
No.
No. So, then I come to you and tell you, young man, how old are you now? 25. How long have you worked? 1 year, 2 years. I want to enter into an agreement with you. I am going to pay you all your earnings until retirement, the age of 60. That means how many years? 35 years, isn't it? And as long as you commit on this contract, never to work, and if I ever catch you working, I will draw the money from your account. Would you take the offer? Would you take the offer? I'm sure many people would take the offer, isn't it? Because you see, all you would have earned by working, you're getting it up front. Let's assume 100,000 is about $1 million per year, isn't it? That usually gives you that 6 million. Bang! In your bank account. So why work? Just try not to work. Life will be so frustrating, you soon commit suicide. And leave the money to be eaten by others. Okay, to the point? Because the way we are created, what, whenever we say we are happy, we are enjoying, is because you are making a difference for somebody else. Am I communicating?
Yeah.
When you are happiest, for example, say somebody's wedding, and you are the one made in charge, the maid of honor, whatever. Are they called maid of honor? The one who looks after the small one, whatever. What is that one called?
Matron.
Okay, matron. Now, then you run the thing so well, you train the children, and they go nicely without embarrassing you. By the end of the day, you are so excited. Why? My children matched?
Well.
It gives you joy. The way God created us, we enjoy when somebody else
enjoys.
Your parents are so happy, although they dropped out of school in 34. When they hear you in the university, my, they sleep like a lord. And yet they are still 34 dropout. Nothing has changed. But what makes them happy is to hear their children are in the university. Hear me, my daughter is? Yes. Yet they are still 34 dropout. What excites them is that their money and their sacrifice, they are seeing results. You may never help them in any way, but they're excited about it. Are we together? You need to understand clearly, as I finish, that if you truly want joy, you must have a mission. And your mission is always to serve man. You never serve God. Not possible. Because people belong to God, so whenever you serve God, you serve God's people. Am I communicating? So you're an engineer in order to make things better for man, God's creation, God's mankind. Are we together? That's why when you write your mission statement, it will never refer to you. It will refer to what you will do for others. For example, God has called you to rescue people who are perishing in the sin. Your joy was to see more and more rescues from going to hell. So your permission for evangelism. You need to understand that the more people get saved, and that I know, every time I have led somebody to the Lord, I can't even, you know, I'm so happy. There's nothing, whenever I'm discouraged, I don't know anything better than evangelism. You hear somebody come to the Lord and the joy is uncontrollable. I can tell you clearly, the way God has created us, number one, He has hidden our joy in service. So when you talk about work, and I told you work is not preaching. Work is doing what God has created you to do. When you do it, whether it is teaching, whether it is whatever, whenever what you are doing impacts people positively, it honors God and gives you joy. Number two, work is opportunity for creativity. And because God is a creator and we are created in His image, the way to prove you are not a cow is you make things different. When you leave a cow in a place, you just eat the grass. It never thinks about planting new one. Now you need to understand. You need to understand when you are the thing that excites you is to do things differently, isn't it? It's important that there is nothing more enjoyable than to see before I came to this job, things were done like this. Amen. Since I came, I'm doing them like this, and God's people are getting even more blessed. But if you go to a job and you do it the way it was always done, in a mediocre way, and I ask you why, that's the way I found it. It just means you are less than a human being. Remember I told you, human being, God has put in us creativity. Something that matters you, can this thing be done differently? Would it yield better results? You don't just do things the way you found them being done. The first thing is you understand it, so you don't change quickly. You first of all understand what is being done. Then after some you say, is this the result you want? It's important to understand. You know, somebody defined madness, and he said, what is madness? Madness is to do things the same way and expect different results. You need to understand, God created us to be creative. Do things in a different way. And without work, you don't have the opportunity for that feeling of new things. Work gives us the opportunity to be creative. Are we together? So, it means, even if you get no job, some of you are finishing this year, am I right? When you finish, and nobody is willing to employ you, we are not talking about salary, talking about creativity. Go and offer your free services to someone.
Amen.
Once He allows you to do it, every day you will sleep like a lord, although you added nothing. When you see clearly, my presence is making a difference. They may make you a messenger. And you know, most messengers have already given up on themselves. You go there and you say, how can this messenger job be done? After all, I'm a graduate. I can't just do it like a 34 dropouts, like my mother. I must do it differently. And in that creativity, you leave that place different. They may never pay you a salary, but by the time you leave, you remember you changed that place. Are we together?
Yes.
Don't agree to be idle. He was right who said, idle hands, finish it for me. Idle hands, the devil's workshop. In other words, if you want to become a workshop of the devil, just simply be idle. So do not wait to be paid a salary. Offer yourself free of all costs in order to help others. You go to the Yahweh, and because now they are having no money, say, don't worry. I'm going to be an accountant, free of
charge.
That will not stop you applying other places. Am I right?
Yeah.
But before you get that job, it will make a difference in your ways. Am I right?
Yes.
That's what work is. I hope I have helped you to redefine work. But I still have a few minutes. I want you to now tell me where I confused you. Because it's time to unconfuse you. So I don't want to go with you being confused. There is something I say, and it was pretty confusing. Please give me a chance to unconfuse you. But maybe there's something I said and it blessed you. and you like to just say, this God has blessed me. Because when you, your words may be more understood than mine. So if you repeat it, what I say in your own words, somebody might benefit. So it's open. It doesn't have to be a question. It can be a comment about something that has blessed you. Anybody? Yes. Sorry?
I have something.
Yes.
Organization criteria as our vision.
Yeah.
Does it please God? Does it please
you? You see, I'm saying your priorities should always be in this order. When you are checking whether what you are doing is right, number one is, does this please God? Number two, does this please your spouse? I guess you have none. But is it? Yeah. Number, then you now can talk about, does it please my colleagues? Your work colleagues, your boss, come at this time? God. That's why you must, your priorities at the place of work cannot be that you are always at work and you forget you are married. Because then you have wrong priorities, isn't it? And unfortunately, I say it like it's obvious, but many people, even pastors, forget their family because of the church. Am I right?
Yes.
It's not right. It must be God first, family second, the church, God. And if you think I'm the one, I'm not being biblical, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. We are told, if you truly do not want your work for God to be disturbed, don't get, Paul encourages you, don't get
married.
And then he goes on to say, if you do marry, you must take away time of that you are serving the Lord and give it to your spouse. Have you read that chapter? Go and read it again before you marry. If you really don't want to serve the Lord completely without any disturbance, simply don't get
married.
Because the Bible already gives power for your spouse to remind them. In fact, it's saying a woman not married gives all her time to the Lord. Once she marries, she takes away time and gives it to her. And that's the Bible saying. So the Bible expects you to reduce your church work to be available for to your wife. Now, if you don't, and you take 100%, you are married, but you're living like you are a single, and you serve the Lord all the time, you still go to hell. Because you see, you have obeyed God in one day, but on the command to divide up your time to go to the spouse, would you have obeyed it?
No.
No. So God is getting you, please, don't come all the time, please. Some of the time must be with you. And that concept is also in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, they say, if you marry, even if war breaks, you must be given 1 year honeymoon. You know, people go now 3 days, 4 days. In the Old Testament, the command is honeymoon for how long? 1 year. So, have I explained? Okay, yes.
The question is,
yeah.
Your mission in life is, for instance, to disciple the young people, and those people are found in various places.
Yes.
Like in church, in school, or like here in
university. Here.
How do you narrow it down to a specific?
You know, people? Once your mission is clear, the location can keep changing. You know very well God has called you to disciple youth. So the first 3 years, it may be in high school. The next 10 years, may be the university. The other 20 years, may be in the church. But you are still within? Yeah. God may call you to changing the face of the earth with construction. That's why you're a structural engineer or civil engineer. The first three years, maybe on Garissa Road. The other 5 years, maybe on American Road. The other 3 years, maybe among the Eskimos. The important thing is you are living within your calling. Have I answered the question? Okay. Somebody else? Where? Okay.
Mine is just a word of thank you to the man of God. You really encouraged me because the first time I'm in Yowena Bakabete campus, and the first time the Lord made me the chairman of the creative ministry team, I went there and guys used to meet like on Tuesday and on Friday. Then I went and started my own things the way I was feeling like doing. We meet on Saturday and then we have a nice time to do the acting and the theater things. Then it's all of a sudden it made a difference. Like guys started liking the family and they started joining and people became more active and the things started now at least making sense.
Mm-hmm. So you're a witness. Creativity helps the people of God. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That doesn't mean you become creative before you understand, because you may change for the worse. So you must also understand. You must first of all understand what is happening before you go on changing. But of course, I'm sure you listened, you watched, then you listened to God, and you started a new thing. Okay, Upper Capet is where I was the other day. Okay.
My question is, first of all, I must say I'm really blessed by the message. I've taken points that were really beneficial to me. I just have a question. In the work environment, on bootlicking, probably if you are under a boss, and I'm not really bootlicking, you're working under a boss, and the instructions that they give you, you're not comfortable with maybe executing whatever they're telling you, and you know that... if you execute it, if you don't execute it, it will
have
problems. Yeah. So.
And if you execute it,
then everything will be okay with you, or probably.
But is it? Because you are creating a problem. Now, if everything will be okay, so what's the problem then? What's wrong with the instructions?
Probably you don't.
If you obey them, what will happen?
If you obey them, you will feel like spiritually, because probably you're at
a... Or you are, if you obey them, you'd contradict what God wants.
Yes.
That's what I wanted you to say.
Yeah.
But I didn't want to say it to myself. So the critical problem is, do I obey God or obey my boss? And what's the answer? In other words, remember God gave you that job. Am I right? Unless, of course, you break to get it. But if God gave you the job, where he got this one, there are more remaining. Am I communicating? It was him who gave you. So you just tell your boss, sorry, that kind of thing I don't do. Why? Because it's contradicting my faith. So I can't do it. But I'm willing to do the job you have given me. And when I took it, I did not know that you asked me to do such things. Obviously, he will fire you. If he does... You are in God's hands. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
Number two, if he fires you, it will live to haunt him. Because you know there are people still remaining. A lot of bosses think that a job is such a big thing. When he realizes you are willing to be jobless to honor God, what kind of message do you think it will leave him? He will be totally changed. And maybe God loves that man so much, he knows the only way you can break to his heart is to fire you. So, you are happy to be fired for him to find the Lord. Am I communicating? Yeah. So, you need to understand that. But, however, my experience is, it's a dangerous thing for a boss to try to fire a Christian. Because if you try to fire a Christian, and the Lord wants him there, you know, one boss told me, two of us cannot work here together. I thought I'm the one to be fired because I was the junior. Within 6 months, he was out. He was right. Two of us could not work. Two of us could not work together. And I understood, because I did exactly what you are saying. He told me to do it. I said, no, I can't do it that way. He said, John, are you aware we cannot work here? Both of us cannot work here together. I said, I'm aware. And I know you are the boss. But you know, please, if you don't give me clear instructions that are in line with my work, I don't have an alternative. So I went and told Rebecca, now I know. The Lord intends us to pay the school fees of our children from somewhere else, not in Shell. Because I knew the Lord will still provide. The only thing, he will not use Shell. I mean, he will use something, he will use somebody else. So I told her we should be ready. But I said, I know he is harassing me like that for me to resign. I'm unlikely to ever resign. I want him to get a testimony. Exactly what I'm telling you. So I was ready now for being fired any time. And my children were in lower primary. But I knew God can provide. To my surprise, within 6 months after he gave me the threat, he was out of the company. So you need to understand, you need to make up your mind. If the Lord wants you to work elsewhere, why do you want to continue there? You close his door, and if he closes the door, he could open a window. You will find a place to enter. So, am I clear?
Yes.
So you need to be aware, it must always be. However, your boss is a supervisor, and the Lord uses him. The idea of being insubordinate, not cooperating with your boss because you are saved, will send you to hell yourself. Because obedience and respect of authority is a New Testament concept, very clear, isn't it? In fact, the New Testament says when you work, you should not work just when your boss is near. Have you read that one?
Yes.
So it's important to understand, as a Christian, you respect your boss, you honor him, and you do the things that both will be for what will bring profit to your company, and in addition to that, honor God. But the minute they cross the line, you are not in doubt. You will not do things that disobey God. Are you together?
Yeah.
Who wants to be the last one to? Yes?
I'm sure you have already shared. There are this issue of company parties.
Company parties. No problem. By the way, I started from a very low level. I retired when I was in the top leadership team, in the management team. So initially, I didn't have influence. By the time I was at the top, I have influence on what happens in the company parties. Three things you need to understand when you're in a company, non-Christian company. Number one, they are not Christians. So you cannot stop them doing. The fact that I don't take alcohol myself does not mean they cannot take alcohol, because then it would have to be a Christian company. Now, if TF started giving us alcohol, I can challenge them. But Shell is not a Christian. So the first thing you must understand is, you cannot determine for people what is enjoyable and what is not enjoyable. So it is important to understand you are the one who can't take. The others can take. Number two, please understand the party is an opportunity for ministry. People you have never, you know it is everybody's there. Like normally messengers don't talk to you. Now you are mixing. In a free atmosphere, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Or your boss, you never talk to him. I mean, he's always serious. Now you can tell him about the Lord, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So I see them as opportunities. And people, you know, come and ask you real serious issues. Because they are free with you and it's not a work environment. So company parties are opportunities for breakthrough in ministry. And if you look at them like that, then obviously you go there. And the only way people can meet you is because... Some people think the reason you don't drink is because you don't have enough money. So when it is free and you don't take it, you make them understand. It is not poverty. It is you have decided not to drink. Then there are girls throwing away, drink themselves. I don't know many girls who are subordinates. You are the manager. And now they are available, trying to be close, want to be taken pictures with you. How you behave will communicate. Are we together? And the party gives you that opportunity. So I'll not fail to go for the company party, because then I'll be breaking an opportunity for ministry. Thirdly, and importantly, as you get opportunity, you can restructure it, isn't it? You can decide where to go and what kind of drinks to come and how long, how many drinks one can take. All that you can have influence. Initially, you may not. And by the time you reach the top, it's important to understand you do not... From the time bar open to closure, you can create a rule. Why? These are people's wives. You want them to go back to their husbands, isn't it? And nobody will say, me, I'm okay. I don't want to go to my husband. Now, you need to understand, you can create rules that help people to operate within. Like, I used to be the manager in Kisumu in the 80s. And I now, as the CEO of that region, I could determine what happened in the party. Are we together? For example... My children were young when we were living in Kisumu in the 80s. I introduced families to act for us, skits. I'm not saying mine, I'm saying all of us. Bring your family, let them act. But mine are going to act a Christian play. Are you getting the point? Yeah, they will be very happy. But I know the play will remain in the people's mind. Then another will act, another one will make a joke, but they have already heard. Because you can't preach to them in a company party, but you can find a way of passing on the message without a sermon. Are we together?
Yes.
Have I answered your question? You wanted to say something?
Yes. For me, I would like to thank you for speaking to us, and especially to me. I have listened to many of your sermons and lectures, and I feel like we connect. You know, there are people who come to speak to you, and you can tell maybe your destiny is
different.
Yeah, or the same.
Okay.
It could not be the same as yours because I know where I'm leading to, but it's something close to that.
Okay.
So God has been.
You feel the Lord. Remember, I told you the important is hear God.
Yeah.
So when you hear from your uncle, it will not be obeying your uncle, but the uncle is confirming what you've already heard from. So I'm saying something confirming what you've already heard.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Now don't ask for more questions because then I'll be disobeying, and it's good to obey. But if you are interested in more of this information, it's in my website. Those who are there last time, if you just Google work, you'll find there's a lot of information in my website. Even currently, I'm writing on work. So this topic, you'll find this information. I've been writing for about 3 months. My website is straightforward. Okay. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. If you go there, you can search. They give you a bar to search. You can search the topic of work. But if you like what I'm writing on work to come to you, go to the homepage and put your email address there. Then every time I put a new message, you don't have to come to my website. It will automatically, I don't know how it works, but whoever runs the website tells me if somebody puts his email address, every time I put new material, it automatically goes. And it will come to your email. So if you're interested in this information, because I've run out of time, I think I would encourage you to just go to the website and then put your email address so that we can continue conversing. And if you want more, if you have a question, you can again use my website to write to me to ask me the question. And it costs me nothing because I have a Zuku at home and I pay the same figure whether I send 1 email or 1 million emails. So it will not cost me anything. So do not say that with me and say, oh, he's answering too many letters. Just email me and I'll reply and I will not pay any more. Are we together? Yeah. Could we pray together? Lord, many of these young people have not tasted work, but they are doing studies, which is also work. I'm praying that the principles we have learned will be principles that make a difference with immediate effect by their attitude to classwork and their attitude to their careers. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. I'll leave a few of my books with somebody so that if you're interested in picking a copy, you can pick. Is that okay?
Yes.
Baraka ya Bwana.
Yes.